Good morning, New City Fellowship. So grateful again to have life on today that the Lord has granted us, that we get to worship our God, even virtually together. So thankful for each and every one of you. Just again, so proud of just New City Fellowship, how we are continuing to, by God's grace, weather in the storm of all the things that are happening in our nation, the pandemic, all these things. And so it's a joy to be able to still continue to push into one another, learn from one another, lean on one another, carry each other's burdens, and to be able to just pray for one another. With that being said, I want to remind us that we have prayer weekly on Wednesdays, 6:30 a.m. Please do join us for that. We want to be continually praying with and for each other. Also, if you are in need or any way, you can continue to reach out to the deacons. The deacons actually have a report during an offertory time that will be played for you to listen to that report. And or if you want to reach out to the session or the women's ministry teams or life groups, all those areas are available to you. So please do reach out. On this week, I want to also be reminding you that this is the last, I believe, session, lesson for the Church Cares curriculum. We'll be going through lesson 12. And so review lesson 12, and the discussion, the Zoom discussion, will be Thursday at 8 p.m. Discussing the final lesson 12. And the hope is really to do this Church Cares curriculum potentially ongoing. We need to be continuing to learning and be refreshed how we can care well for others, especially on this very important topic. So if you're a leader in any way at New City Fellowship, we want to encourage you to continue to look at that information through Church Care, so that we can just kind of be unified in terms of how to be able to talk about such of those issues. And it'll be an ongoing thing that we want to continue to educate ourselves on how we can care for others. And I also want to remember, for prayer wise, remember to pray for just the flooding that happened in the Midland area. Many are still recovering from that. Even in our own denominations, there was Pastor Sarah Folian and a couple church members, and just really that whole community needs continual prayer. So, and there's also the OPC disaster relief. If you can contribute to that, please do. Or you have any questions, reach out to us, how we can get you connected with that. So we want to be continuing praying for that situation. And so without further ado, let us join together in our call for worship.
Good morning. Our call to worship this morning is taken from Isaiah chapter 12, verses 4 through 6. Give praise to the Lord, proclaim his name, make known among the nations what he has done, and proclaim that his name is exalted. Sing to the Lord, for he has done glorious things, and let this now be known to all the world. Shout aloud and sing for joy, people of Zion, for great is the Holy One of Israel among you. Let's sing together, let your kingdom come, let your kingdom come.
Thank you.
Let us join together in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning, bringing our praise and proclaiming that your name is exalted. You have done glorious things. You are great among us. You are known in all the world. We worship you. We have sung, "Let your kingdom come, let your will be done." And we do plead that your kingdom of righteousness and justice may be realized in our lives, in our church, in our nation, and throughout the world. May your sovereign work on earth be done. We pray for our leaders in local, state, and federal government. Give them wisdom, turn their eyes towards those in need, and equip them to act justly and courageously. We confess our sins to you. We repent of our selfishness and ask that you might enlarge our hearts and open our eyes. Give us wisdom. Turn our eyes towards those who are in need. Equip us to act justly and courageously. We are weak, but we ask that you strengthen us to do the good works that you have prepared beforehand for us to do. Lord, lead and guide us this week. Help us walk in the paths of righteousness. Let us be your servants in our words and in our actions through the power of the Holy Spirit. This we pray in the powerful name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Greetings, New City Fellowship Church. This is Chris DeReicher, Deacon of New City Fellowship. I was asked to give an update on the state of the diaconate and what's going on at New City Fellowship Church. And before I do that, I just want to give glory to God. There's been some amazing things happening here at New City, and it's been fun to witness those a little bit more closely than some of y'all get the chance to. So this update is to encourage you to kind of let you know what's going on, and as an opportunity to thank those who've served. So thank you so much. There's been a lot of people that have been getting involved, and I just want to encourage New City Fellowship to keep doing that. What you're doing has impact on the lives of those that we serve, on our congregation and our community. And I want to encourage you to keep being generous, maybe even find new and exciting ways to serve those in kind of a special time. Think about ways you might be able to budget as a family, even a small portion every month, to be giving to the benevolence at New City, or finding a specific need in your community or your neighbors or at work. I think this is just such an opportunity for the church to be about the gospel and to be sharing the love of Jesus Christ with those that we come into contact with. So please do so. But I wanted to let you know, what have we been up to? What have we been doing as deacons? So here are a couple of things. And you've got a update from the deacons a couple of weeks ago, or maybe a week ago. Some of this is review, but many of you have been helping deliver meals to single fathers and mothers, serving the elderly, bringing them to their appointments, providing some help, even making phone calls to them just to encourage them and give them some, just a little bit of relationship. I think that's needed definitely right now for those who are lonely. There have been people getting involved by mowing lawns for some of the elderly. Some of these things have been really cool to see your heart to serve. You may know Victor Farley. He's been attending New City Fellowship for years, and recently he's been dealing with a problem of reoccurring flooding in his apartment. This has damaged some of his personal belongings. This has caused frustration and hardship for him. And we've just been able to help him with temporary housing while his landlord works on correcting the problem and helping to provide, hopefully, a healthy and safe place for Vic to live. So continue to pray for that he'd have that need met. And we'll be monitoring that situation and updating you. Second, a cool opportunity was Marie, that's been attending New City Fellowship for a while now. Her main languages are French, Spanish, and Creole. So if you are able to speak in those languages, please reach out to her. I know she knows some English as well. But she was also in a living situation that was not ideal. A lot of people coming and going, overcrowded. She just did not feel safe there. So when she was given a short-term opportunity for housing, she was overjoyed, just incredibly thankful for what New City Fellowship was able to help with. And I'm so thankful to see that work out for her. Another recent example of God's goodness was to the DeReicher family, missionaries here at New City. They were hoping to evacuate when the pandemic struck, and unfortunately were not able to find transportation, a flight out of Haiti. When they did finally secure flights, the expense was incredible. It was almost $10,000 for them to leave Haiti to come back home to where they'd be safe and to reassess the situation. And about a week or two ago, we had done an offering for that specific need. And I'm happy to report that all of the funds have been raised to support their evacuation from Haiti. So thank you, thank you, thank you. That's an amazing example of God's grace and generosity. And I want to encourage you to think about and pray all of the missionaries, pray for them, all the missionaries that are serving around the world. There are specific ones that our congregation supports and that our denomination supports. And you may know others in your family and friends. Be looking for ways to support them. They are sacrificing every day their resources and their time to serve in the kingdom, and they love to do that. I know that, but it is challenging at times, so pray for them. I wanted to kind of conclude with, why do the deacons love to serve? And why would we want to encourage you to serve? It's not about us. Obviously, it's about what God is doing and how we can be a part of that. It's been such a joy to see all the opportunities to be able to personally bear fruit in serving others, and most of all, to be a part of sharing the love of Jesus Christ, our greatest need, with those that God brings to New City Fellowship and that we see in our community. So I want to encourage you to do that, because there's really nothing, I think, that'll bring greater joy than when we get to serve Christ and to share the love of Christ with others. So I'm going to conclude with a prayer. Pray for the offering, and so pray with me, New City. Dear Lord in heaven, thank you for just everybody at New City Fellowship Church. Keep them safe, keep them healthy. Most of all, Lord, point them to you. May you be a guide to them. May you be their comfort, and may we put all of our hope and trust in you. Thank you for the funds that have been collected today. May they be multiplied and used mightily in your kingdom. May your name be glorious throughout the world. We pray for the pastor as he preaches. Give Doug wisdom and give him a heart of love for others. And may our hearts be turned more towards you. We love you and we praise you and thank you. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Good morning, New City. It is my privilege to be with you this morning and to have the opportunity to open together God's Word with you. Let me first direct your attention to God's Word as it is found in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 12 through 20. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 12 through 20. I'm reading for the New International Version, the 1984 edition. Everything is permissible for me, but not everything is beneficial. Everything is permissible for me, but I will not be mastered by anything. Food for the stomach and the stomach for food. But God will destroy them both. The body is not meant for sexual immorality, but for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. By his power, God raised the Lord from the dead, and he will raise us also. Do you not know that your bodies are members of Christ himself? Shall I then take the members of Christ and unite them with a prostitute? Never. Do you not know that he who unites himself with a prostitute is one with her in body? For it is said, the two shall become one flesh. But whoever is united with the Lord is one with him in spirit. Flee from sexual immorality. All other sins a person commits are outside the body, but whoever sins sexually sins against his own body. Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit, who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. You were bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your bodies. Also, Matthew chapter 5, verses 14 through 16. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hid. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your lights shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father, who is in heaven. Galatians 2, 19 through 21. For through the law, I died to the law so that I might live for God. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. In the life I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness could be gained through the law, Christ died for nothing. The subject from God's word for today is our bodies as the temple of the Holy Spirit. This is always an important subject, but it is especially relevant because of the events of these last weeks and months. I am speaking to you today over this electronic platform due to restrictions placed upon us because of the COVID-19 pandemic. In order to avoid the rapid spread of the virus, the government has required that we stay at home and has prohibited large group meetings, including worship assemblies. The pandemic has disrupted lives throughout the world, medically, economically, and vocationally. It has also made us aware of our physical existence and how fragile it is. It has reminded us of our mortality, as over 110,000 of our fellow citizens have died. It has impressed us with the need to protect our own lives and the lives of others. Lockdowns, closing of businesses, social distancing, wearing of masks. While this virus is no respecter of persons, it has revealed those who may have special vulnerabilities, those who are older, those who are overweight, those who have diabetes, those who have lung ailments, those who have compromised immune systems or immune disorders. It has also made visible various needs and amplified the differences within the strata of society. The need for food, as food banks have been overcrowded and overwhelmed. The job security of the less fortunate, especially those who are not able to work from home. The greater mortality rate for the poor and for people of color because of disparities in health and health care. It has revealed and aggravated the distance between the richer and poorer in terms of job security, educational opportunity, availability of medical care. It has also thwarted those in our culture who are eager or even obsessed to obtain a certain body image, or who pride themselves regarding physical appearance, physical fitness, or fashion sense. The beauty parlors, the barber shops, the nail salons, and the clothing stores have all been closed. The gyms and physical fitness centers have been shuttered. The COVID epidemic has also revealed our cultural addiction to pleasure, our longing to eat at certain restaurants, to have certain experiences, to drink coffee at our favorite coffee bar, and the frustration that we have experienced in not being able to do those things. It has also disrupted our personal interactions and relationships. People in nursing homes cannot be visited in person except through a window if they are fortunate enough to have a ground floor room. Medical workers on the front line worry about carrying the virus back home to their families. People seriously stricken with the virus are going into the hospital and sometimes facing their final days and hours alone without the comfort or touch of their loved ones. Those who are bereaved cannot receive the personal touch and comfort of their family and friends. No hugs, no family visitation, no memorial services, no opportunities to reminisce, to share stories, to grieve and to weep together. And it has also impeded our worship. It's good that we can meet electronically like this, and I'm glad for all of you who have tuned in here this morning. It is good that we can still gather around God's word, that God's word is not chained. But I think we can all agree that doing this is not the same as physically gathering in solemn assembly before the Lord. We miss the singing, the hugs, the informal conversations, being able to see each other, the weekly congregational meals, the corporate worship, the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. These changes and deprivations remind us of many things, but they point to a basic truth. We are bodily creatures. And our bodies are important, and they require care. Food and health, to be sure, but also touch, affection, love. All these needs arise from our possessing physical bodies. Now, for all of its harm, the coronavirus has done something positive. It has provided the opportunity to draw a strong contrast between the world's view of the body and the Christian view of the body, and how we ought to care for it and how we ought to use it. Those two viewpoints are not the same. And I would like to begin this morning by contrasting the world's preoccupation with consumption and obsession with body image and addiction to pleasure over against the biblical view that our body is the temple of the Holy Spirit. The Greeks had an ideal notion of the body. Plato believed that there was such a thing as an ideal human form, and this led to the Greek notion that the ideal human being was a perfect mind in a perfect body. Many years ago, I received an email from a friend entitled, "David Goes Back to Italy." Michelangelo's famous statue, David, had gone on a 3-year tour across the United States and was returning back to Florence, Italy. Most of you are probably familiar with the statue. It is a Renaissance masterpiece. It is an astonishingly striking and powerful representation of a handsome young man sculpted in white marble. If you're not familiar with it, I encourage you to look it up. As Michelangelo sculpts this statue, he is following the Greek ideal of perfection. However, the email I received contained a satirical spoof on what had happened to the statue David after spending 3 years in the United States. David is going back to Italy, a changed man. And the email contained a computer-generated image of the statue David after he had put on about 60 pounds. It's quite a humorous picture. And on the satirical spoof, there were listed as his proud sponsors at the base of this spoof, McDonald's, Kentucky Fried Chicken, and Starbucks. Now, this is amusing, but it points also to a real problem. We are eating ourselves to death in this country. Over 60% of adult Americans are overweight or obese. We are presently the heaviest nation in the world. That is having all kinds of impact on our life and our health. Obesity is the second leading cause after smoking and preventable death. Since 1980, obesity rates in this country have doubled. So also rates of type 2 diabetes have doubled among adults and becoming increasingly common among children and teenagers, where it was hardly ever found before. In his amusing but sobering informal documentary, Supersize Me, Morgan Spurlock exposes our national obesity problem by subjecting himself to a McDonald's-only diet for 30 days, and everything that he ordered on the menu, he ordered it supersized. In those 4 weeks, he gained 25 pounds. He doubled his cholesterol and triglyceride levels. At 3 weeks, his liver function was so impaired that one of his doctors pled with him to stop the experiment. It took 6 months after the trial was over to get back to his normal weight. However, as focused as our culture is with food in general and fast food in particular, it is equally addicted to the concept of body image. We, like the Greeks, have embraced the notion of the ideal form, both male and female. And even though we're terrible at attaining it, it dominates our society as to provoke another national obsession: diet and exercise. Billions of dollars are spent on diet programs and diet supplements and diet pills and medications or makeup and anti-aging creams. Magazines and TV ads are full of all kinds of exercise equipment. Our obsession with a particular form has led to a spate of different eating disorders as well. This used to be a primary problem of young women who tended to make odious comparisons between their perception of themselves and the cultural ideal. But more recently, it's becoming an increased problem for men as well. Witness the huge sale of exercise equipment, gym memberships, and advertisements for obtaining a symmetrical set of washboard abs. Our emphasis on food and body image is reinforced by our commitment in this culture to hedonism. And hedonism is very simply the philosophy that pleasure is the highest good, the viewpoint that pleasure is the highest good. Paul refers to this philosophy when he cites the hedonistic proverb in 1 Corinthians 15:32, "Eat, drink, and be merry, for tomorrow we die." Elevating pleasure to the highest good has tremendous impact on our lives and the way we view our bodies. It divorces food from nutrition and strength. It encourages us to gluttony, in which the pleasure of consuming food and drink becomes an end in itself. It removes our sexuality from the domain of love, intimacy, and procreation, and reduces it simply to an instrument of personal pleasure. Now, even from these few remarks, it is clear that the issue of how we treat our bodies is not only relevant, but it borders on a national medical and moral emergency. Does the truth that the body is the temple of the Holy Spirit give us any insight into these issues? The answer is, of course, yes. But it does so in ways that we might not have expected, that we might find surprising or even counterintuitive. So now we turn to the Christian emphasis on our bodies as temples of the Holy Spirit. The passage I read earlier from 1 Corinthians 6:12 through 20 is the classic biblical text on the body being the temple of the Holy Spirit. If you have a Bible available, turn to it now, that passage now in 1 Corinthians 6 if you can, and stick your thumb in it, because we'll be looking at it and referring to it several times. As Paul writes to the Corinthian church, he is writing to a church that is full of enthusiasm, but not much wisdom or discipline. He is also writing to a church that is surrounded by sin, selfishness, wealth, and immorality. Corinth was an affluent commercial and commerce city. It was the intersection of both land and sea trade routes. And as a commercial and sailor's town, it was filled with the kind of vices that such trade ports often offered. Paul is trying to explain to them and to instruct them as to how to live godly lives surrounded by such temptations. As you probably noticed when I read the text early on, the primary concern and application of the text is about avoiding sexual immorality. Now, this is worth a sermon in itself, but I'm not going to preach that sermon today. Ask me back sometime, and I'll be happy to do that. I could easily devote the rest of our time to that subject. I don't want to focus on that subject today, this morning, but a few words are in order because of the strong emphasis in the text, and I feel compelled to make at least a few observations. First of all, Paul teaches us that our bodies are not simply instruments of pleasure. They belong to the Lord, and they are not to be used for immoral activity. To do so, says Paul, and he argues this carefully, is unseemly, because our bodies belong to the Lord, and they have been redeemed for godly and gospel purposes. Secondly, he reminds us that sexual immorality tends to be addictive, because sexual sin tends to master us, that the immoral person sins against his own body, leading to ungodly habits of behavior that are difficult to break. And this suggests that if you have a besetting sexual sin or addiction, you need more than advice. You need more than someone simply tell you to stop it. You need help. You need accountability. And I would just urge you, if this is a struggle in your life, to talk to somebody, to share that struggle with someone you trust, and make yourself accountable to an individual or an accountability group. Now, that's all I want to say. I think that's important, but that's all I want to say on that particular aspect of this text. Because while a main concern of this passage is avoiding sexual immorality, it is clearly not its exclusive concern. Verses 12 and 13 of 1 Corinthians chapter 6 refers to the stomach and food. Paul says, "Everything is permissible for me, but not everything is beneficial. Everything is permissible for me, but I will not be mastered by anything. Food for the stomach and the stomach for food, but God will destroy them both." Now, the language here clearly includes matters outside the realm of human sexuality. Food is specifically mentioned, but his reference to everything, everything is permissible, or all things, clearly has a broader reference. It includes good things that may be permissible, that may be lawful, but that are not beneficial, that are not helpful. Lots of things can become a problem. Indeed, Any good thing can become a problem or idolatrous if it is made a matter of ultimate concern. A particular note is the idea that we're not to be mastered by anything. We're not to be controlled by anything. Since this text refers to food as a good but not an ultimate, and given the way our culture is being dominated by food and fast food, certainly this text applies to our current situation and warns us against being mastered by bad eating habits. Food is good, but we are not to be mastered by it. This suggests that we should receive food as a gift from God, that we should be thankful for it, but that we should not let it control our lives. This is certainly relevant to the issue of food and fitness, but Paul says more. At the end of this passage, Paul draws a conclusion whose implications go way beyond the issues of food or sexual morality. Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. You were bought at a price. Therefore, honor or glorify God with your bodies. Now, this passage tells us many things. It tells us that if we are Christians, we possess the Holy Spirit that dwells within us. It tells us that we are not our own, that we have been purchased by the cross of Christ, that great price. It tells us also that we are under new management. We have become slaves or servants of Jesus. It also summons us to honor and glorify or bring praise to God through the instrumentality of our bodies. But what does that mean? Certainly it means that we're not to abuse our bodies or use them inappropriately. We are to avoid, as Paul has already stated, gluttony or prostitution. But I think it means something more. And here's where the surprise comes in this text. Paul's words remind us of the words of Jesus found in the Sermon on the Mount, which moves us in a different direction. Matthew 5:14-16, "You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on a stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven." Jesus here in Matthew chapter 5 instructs us that we are to glorify God by our good works. We glorify God when we use our bodies for instruments of godliness, not idolatry or immorality. And this is certainly consistent with 1 Corinthians 6. As Paul says in 1 Corinthians 10:31, whether we eat, drink, or all that we do, we are to do it all to the glory of God. We are to glorify God in our bodies. That brings us to this whole notion of our bodies as temples, the indwelling Spirit of Christ. Paul emphasizes this other point. Our bodies are temples. They are meant to be a place where the Spirit of Christ dwells and presumably where the presence of Christ shapes what we do. Paul makes this same point in Galatians 2:19-21 that I read at the head of this study. "For through the law I died to the law so that I might live for God. I have been crucified with Christ, and it is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life that I now live in the body, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness could be gained through the law, then Christ died for nothing." To be temples of the Holy Spirit means that the Spirit of Jesus lives in us. It means that we are instruments of Jesus' purpose, that we are created in Christ Jesus for good works that God has prepared beforehand that we should walk in them, and that he is the one dwelling in us who enables us to do so. This is vitally, vitally important. The emphasis in 1 Corinthians 6 is not simply that our body is the temple of the Holy Spirit and therefore we ought to take good care of it. Rather, the emphasis is that the body is the dwelling place of Christ through his Spirit, and we should therefore act like it, like Christ is dwelling in us. Well, You might say, wait a minute, how does this relate to the way we care for and use our bodies? Well, it does, but not entirely in the way that you might think. Paul does not ignore or criticize physical fitness, but he doesn't elevate it either. In 1 Timothy 4:8, Paul comments to Timothy that physical training, exercise, is of some value, but godliness has value for all things, holding promise for both the present life and the life to come. Now, don't misunderstand me or Paul. The Bible does want us to care for our bodies. But the idea that our bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit is not designed to produce or promote a certain body image as much as it is to summon us to love and to good works. The primary focus is on how we are to use our bodies to glorify God, not on how much exercise and care we give to our bodies. The concern is to avoid idolatry and be rich in good works. Food is good, but it must not become an idol. Sexuality is good, but it must not become an idol. Our bodies are the temples of the Holy Spirit, but this means that our bodies also must not become an idol. We are not to be mastered even by good things. We are not to be preoccupied with body image, and sometimes the way that we pursue a perfect body image through our exercise or dietary regimens, it becomes just that. It becomes a preoccupation with how we look. Instead, we are as temples of the Holy Spirit to glorify God with our bodies. We are to direct our bodies to love and good works. And it is this emphasis that puts a different spin on this particular topic. Let me stress this for you here. The bodies we are to care for are not simply our own bodies, but this text is summoning us to care for other people's bodies, not simply our own. Let me try to draw this together and some implications for taking care of our bodies. The Bible has a very positive view of the body. This is seen in the doctrine of the resurrection, which Paul refers to also in this text in 1 Corinthians 6:14. We are comprised of a body-soul unity, and salvation consists of our being saved and redeems a body-soul unity as well. It is not just our soul that is saved, but our whole being. And that is why we maintain the doctrine of the resurrection and the incarnation. The salvation will be completed at the resurrection when our bodies and souls are joined together, because both body and soul are important. And because of this, because the bodies are viewed as important, we should care for them. We shouldn't treat them harshly. We especially should not treat them harshly for religious purposes, as Paul speaks about in Colossians. These things have the appearance of wisdom in the severe treatment of the body, but they're no value against fleshly indulgence. We should care for our bodies, not treat them harshly. The Bible also understands that most of us naturally seek to care for our own bodies. When Paul instructs husbands in Ephesians chapter 5 to love their wives as their own bodies, he points out that no one despises his body, but nourishes it and it cherishes it. And so because we automatically nourish and cherish our own bodies, and since we are to love our wives as our own bodies, so husbands should nourish and cherish their own wives. When Jesus tells us to love our neighbor as ourselves, he's not giving us some third commandment. He's not telling us to love ourselves. He's telling us to love our neighbor in the same way that we normally love ourselves. We naturally love ourselves, but we are to treat others in the same way that we would be treated. We are to do unto others the way we would have them do unto us. The scriptural encouragements to take care of the body, to treat it with respect, usually come in the form of specific commands. For example, we're not to be filled with wine in an excessive way, but to be filled with the Holy Spirit. The Sabbath principle tells us that work is good, but also not ultimate, that God gives us not only work to do, but also gives his children rest. We are not to rise up early, sit up late, eat the bread of anxious toil, for God gives his loved ones sleep. So is it biblically appropriate to get exercise, to moderate our food intake, and to get sufficient sleep? Absolutely, providing that that request does not become an all-consuming passion for a certain body image, which brings us to our next point. The Bible is not greatly concerned about body image. Since the image we are primarily reflect is God or Christ, the general principle for men and women is that men or human beings look on the outward appearance, but God looks on the heart. While the Bible identifies Rachel and Esther as being especially beautiful, and David and Absalom as being especially handsome, and so does not despise the reality of human beauty, that is not where the emphasis lies. Beauty is best seen as a reflection of character. The woman of Proverbs 31 may have been very lovely. Interestingly, the text doesn't say so, but the woman of Proverbs 31 may have been very lovely, but it is not her physical beauty that is praised. It is her kindness, her diligence, her productivity, her trustworthiness, and her faithfulness as a wife and mother. Both Paul and Peter encourage women not to outward beauty or adornment, but to the inner beauty of a spiritual woman who is not driven by any fear. And that's consistent with the book of Proverbs. Thus, the writer of Proverbs tells us that charm is deceitful and beauty is fleeting, but a woman who reverences the Lord, she shall be praised. Likewise, while the Bible does recognize certain physical abilities like Samson's strength or David's mighty men, it does not elevate these to the level of an ideal which should be imitated by all. Indeed, all of our earthly abilities, accomplishments, and physical features need to be put in perspective. And Jeremiah 9:23-24 makes this clear. This is what the Lord says. Let not the wise man boast of their wisdom, or the strong boast of their strength, or the rich boast of their riches, but let the one who boasts boast about this, that they understand and know me, that I am the Lord, who exercises kindness, justice, and righteousness on earth, for in these I delight, declares the Lord. You hear what Jeremiah is saying here? The rich man isn't to rejoice and focus on his riches. The intelligent man isn't to rejoice or focus on his education or his intelligence. The athletic or military person is not to focus on their strength, but they are to rejoice in the knowledge of God. To put it another way, seeing our body as the temple of the Holy Spirit should summon us, first of all, to cherish the Christ that dwells within us. The Christ that dwells within us. Does this mean that we should get rid of all our exercise equipment? That we should cancel our gym membership? That we should stop preparing to run the 10K river run or a marathon? Certainly not. But should we share our culture's obsession with body image? Absolutely not. The image we should be concerned about is Christ's image. Romans 8:28-30 makes this clear. We know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him, who've been called according to his purpose. And what is that purpose? For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. What implications does this have for caring for others? Well, first, all things are lawful, all things are permissible, but we are not to be mastered by anything. Food and exercise are good, but they are not ultimate. We are not to become obsessed with our own body. We are not to worship it. However, there is a body that is to be the constant object of our concern. And it is the body or bodies that belong to other people. If we glorify God in our bodies, we must let our light so shine before men that they may see our good works and give glory to God who is in heaven. But what does that look like? If our bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit, so that Christ and the Spirit of Christ lives in us, if we have been crucified with Christ so that we no longer live, but Christ lives in us, what is it that the indwelling Christ wants us to do? And I think the answer comes to us when we consider Jesus' expectation of us in the illustration of the sheep and the goats. In Matthew 25, 31 to 45, Jesus recounts an illustration of something that will occur and points to the end times when the Son of God will come in glory and also in judgment. Matthew 25, 31 to 45. When the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, he will sit on his glorious throne, and all the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate the people from one another as a shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. He will put the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. Then the king will say to those on his right, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, take your inheritance, the kingdom prepared for you since the creation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me." Then the righteous will answer, "Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you?" And the king will reply, "Truly I tell you, whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers and sisters of mine, you did it for me." And then he will say to those on his left, "Depart from me, you are cursed, into the eternal fire prepared for the devil and his angels. For I was hungry, and you gave me nothing to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me nothing to drink. I was a stranger, and you did not invite me in. I needed clothes, and you did not clothe me. I was sick and in prison, and you did not look after me." And they also will answer, "Lord, when did we see you hungry or thirsty or a stranger or needing clothes or sick or in prison and did not help you?" And he will reply, "Truly I tell you, whatever you did not do for one of the least of these, you did not do it to me." Jesus' point is clear. Seeing our body as the temple of the Holy Spirit, knowing that Jesus dwells in us, should drive us to be other-centered and not to be self-absorbed. If we glorify God in our bodies, we should not be overly anxious about how we look, but we should be concerned about whether others are clothed and housed. If we glorify God in our bodies, we should not be overly concerned about what we eat, but we should be concerned about others who are hungry. If we glorify God in our bodies, we should not be overly concerned generally with ourselves, but we should look to others who need our companionship or care. And why is this the case? This is because Jesus dwells in us. We are no longer ourselves. We have been bought with a price. We have been crucified with Jesus. It is no longer we who live, but Christ who lives in us. In the life we now live, we live by faith in the Son of God who loved us and gave himself for us. Jesus is in us. And Jesus tells us in his word what he wants us to do with this body that he indwells. We are to be concerned for others. Now, this has immediate applications to recent events. First, as things are beginning to open up with the COVID-19 virus, we must continue in our desire to be diligent to protect other people. Don't stop washing your hands. These are the simple things. Don't stop engaging in social distancing. Don't stop wearing masks when you go to the store. Don't whine if you can't get to your favorite restaurant or drink your favorite beverage. Remember, the kingdom of God is not eating or drinking, but righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Romans 14, 17. Write that down and put it on your refrigerator. Second, be generous to those in need. Today is Second Sunday. It is the Sunday in which we normally observe the Lord's Supper. But it is also Benevolence Sunday. When we take communion, as has been the pattern of Reformed churches since the time of the Reformation, since the time of Geneva, we also collect offerings to assist the deacons in their work of mercy. Krista Reicher spoke about the work of the deacons today. There are many needs, and we as a congregation of the Lord Jesus Christ have an opportunity to serve. I hope you gave generously to the deacon's offering this morning. If not, I'm sure they're still glad to hear from you if you want to follow up. But even without the deacons, this text before us this morning encourages us to be generous ourselves, to look for opportunities to do good. As Paul says in Galatians, as we have opportunity, we should do good to all people, especially those who are the household of faith. That's what it means, that it's no longer we who live, but Christ who lives in us. And a third application has to do with what we can do to preserve and protect the lives of others. The sorrow of the virus of the last few months has been amplified by the sorrow of social sadness and difficulty issues and social issues and unrest in our country. The horrific deaths of George Floyd, Ahmaud Arbery, and Breonna Taylor remind us that we are to be concerned about people who may be at risk, not only medically, but also existentially, for no other reason than for the color of their skin. We are, as those who are have the Holy Spirit of God in us, as temples of the Holy Spirit, we are to do what we can to promote life, to promote safety, and to do so for all. Whether we are protecting the life of the born or the unborn, whether we are protecting the lives and encouraged for the lives or jealous for the lives of white, black, Asian, Hispanic, or any other persons of color. We should pray, and we should do all that we can to encourage peace between all peoples in our country and throughout the world. We should be zealous to preserve and promote safety for everybody. Remember the child's rhyme, red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in his sight. Well, we can add a new phrase to that. Red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in his sight. Brown and blue, they image God too. And we need to be concerned for all and be desirous to preserve and to protect and to do good to all in the interests of promoting life and glorifying God. In closing, as you eat and drink, as you diet and exercise, do it before the Lord. But as you minister to your body, think about the ways that you can bless the bodies of others, the way that you can use your body to bring glory to God by your good works directed towards others. Watch what you eat. Avoid sexual immorality. Don't be mastered by anything. That's Paul's core exhortation here in 1 Corinthians 6. Don't worry about your body image except the image of Christ to which you are being conformed. Remember, you are the temple of the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Christ. That's who the Holy Spirit is. He's the Spirit of Christ. Jesus is inside you. You are not your own. You have been bought at an astonishing price. Glorify God in your body. And love your neighbor as yourself. Let's pray. Our Father and our God, we thank you for the clear and powerful instruction of your word, which summons us to love you, the Lord our God, with all of our heart, soul, strength, and mind, and also to love our neighbor as ourselves. That on these two commandments rests all the law and the prophets. Father, help us to gain a better understanding of this. Help us to gain a better understanding of how it is that you are at work in us. And you're at work in us not simply in teaching us and instructing us, but you are working on us from the inside out. That the Lord Jesus and the Spirit of Christ are within us. That our bodies are temples of your Spirit, directing us and guiding us and leading us to do and be what you would have us to be. This is a great mystery, but we pray that you would help us to emphasize not so much how we treat our bodies, but what we do with them as temples of the Holy Spirit. Guide us and direct us. Help us to embrace your teaching that we've been crucified with Christ. It is no longer we who live, but Christ who lives in us. And the life we now live, we live by faith in the Son of God, who loved us and gave himself for us. May that be true in our life. And may you, even in this hour and in this day, begin to transform us from the inside out. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.
Chains are released, I can sing, I am free.
benediction this morning is taken from Hebrews chapter 13, verses 20 through 21. Hebrews chapter 13, verses 20 through 21. Now may the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, equip you with everything good for doing his will. And may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen.